good luck, and I wish you the best. I think we are really privileged in many ways, but today I thought about who can be so privileged to walk through town and experience such temperatures like we do. It really cleans up your mind. It's not bad. But I also thought today, maybe you are sad or a little bit disappointed that you didn't win the Super Bowl, right? So I walked to church today and I thought about, would I give up my baptismal identity, right? My claim to be a child of God for the Super Bowl win. And I thought about it for a long time and I came to the conclusion I wouldn't. And so I think we are really privileged. And today, in that sense, we are going to celebrate the baptism. And we will celebrate the first milestone in our children's life. Please rise with the confession and forgiveness, which is found in your bulletin. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, the maker of heaven and earth, the Word made flesh, the Lord and giver of life. Let us come into the light of Christ, confessing our need for God's mercy. God of peace, we confess that we are not at peace with others. We bring to you all tears as part, discord in our families, violence in our world, our own conflicted hearts. In your mercy, mend us. Reconnect us to one another and to you. Let peace reign over all the earth. To the Prince of Peace, our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. In the world who has come to dwell with us, God has given us grace upon grace. Forgiveness that is stronger than our sins. Love that can heal every broken heart. Hear this word of God's pardon and peace. In the name of our Savior Jesus Christ, you are free from all your sins. Rise, shine, for your light has come. The gathering hymn today is As with Gladness, Men of Old, number 302. And before I do this, before we sing, I just wanted to pass on the cross and make sure that we get it back. Thank you.
Thank you.
of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Join me for the prayer of the day, which is found in your bulletin insert. Almighty God, you anointed Jesus at his baptism with the Holy Spirit and revealed him as your beloved Son. Keep all who are born of water and the Spirit faithful in your service, that we may rejoice to be called children of God, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated. I think we don't have somebody coming up. The first reading today is taken from Isaiah, chapter 43. Oh, it's you? I am sorry.
See. All right. First reading today comes from Isaiah chapter 43, 1 through 7. Never in the end of Israel's exile in Babylon, God promises to bring them home. They need no longer be afraid, because the one who formed, created, and called them by name now redeems them from all the enemies. God declares them precious and honored, and God loves them all. But now thus says the Lord, He who created you, O Jacob, He who formed you, O Israel, do not fear, for I have redeemed you. I have called you by name, you are mine. When you pass through the waters, I will be with you. and through the rivers they shall not overwhelm you. When you walk through the fire, you shall not be burned, and the flame shall not consume you. For I am the Lord your God, the Holy One of Israel, your Savior. I give Egypt as your ransom, Ethiopia and Saba in exchange for you, because you are precious in my sight and honored, and I love you. I give people in return for you, nations in exchange for your life. Do not fear, for I am with you. I will bring your offspring from the east, and from the west I will gather you. I will say to the north, give them up, and to the south, do not withhold. Bring my sons from far away, and my daughters from the end of the earth, everyone who is called by my name, whom I created for my glory, whom I formed and made. Word of the Lord. This psalm this morning, Psalm 29, and I will like to read this together, please, with the refrain. Ascribe to the Lord, ye gods, ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due God's name. Worship the Lord in the beauty of holiness. The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The God of glory thunders. The Lord is upon the mighty waters. The voice of the Lord is a powerful voice. The voice of the Lord is a voice of splendor. The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The voice of the Lord breaks the cedar trees. The Lord breaks the cedars of Lebanon. The Lord makes Lebanon skip like a calf, and Mount Hermon like a young wild ox. The voice of the Lord bursts forth in lightning flashes. The voice of the Lord shakes the wilderness. The Lord shakes the wilderness of Kadesh. The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The voice of the Lord makes the oak trees writhe and stripes the forest bare. Have in the temple of the Lord all are crying glory. The Lord sits enthroned above the flood. The Lord sits enthroned as King forevermore. O Lord, give strength to your people. Give them, O Lord, the blessings of peace. The voice of the Lord is upon the waters. The second reading this morning comes from the book of Acts, chapter 8, 14 through 17. Peter and John are sent to support the new Christians in Samaria, a group that was recently baptized after hearing the good news of Christ through their preaching of Philip. Here the Samaritans receive the gift of the Holy Spirit and the laying on of the hands. Now when the apostles at Jerusalem heard that Samaria had accepted the word of God, they sent Peter and John to them. The two went down and prayed for them that they might receive the Holy Spirit. For as yet the Spirit had not come upon any of them, they had only been baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus. Then Peter and John laid their hands on them, and they received the Holy Spirit, the word of the Lord.
Please rise for the gospel acclamation. Chapter. As the people were filled with expectation and all were questioning in their hearts concerning John whether he might be the Messiah, John answered all of them by saying, I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I is coming. I'm not worthy to untie the thong of his sandals. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. His winnowing fork is in his hand to clear his threshing floor and to gather the wheat into his granary, but the chaff he will burn with unquenchable fire. Now, when all the people were baptized, and when Jesus also had been baptized and was praying, the heavens opened, and the Holy Spirit descended upon him in bodily form like a dove. And a voice came from heaven, "You are my Son, the Beloved. With you I'm well pleased." The Gospel of the Lord. I invite you to be seated as we join our voices to sing "Jesus Loves Me" for the children to come forward. Jesus loves me, this I know, for the Bible tells me so. Little ones to him belong, they are weak, but he is strong. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. Yes, Jesus loves me. The Bible tells me so. Good morning, boys and girls. I would think some of you, maybe not everyone here, has one of those faith chests at home, right? What do you put in a faith chest? Anybody knows? What do you put in there? Yes. Treasures, okay. Something special about Jesus. Very good. Those are all very good thoughts and ideas. Well, Pastor Dirk and I never got a faith chest when we were baptized. We got our faith chest when we became pastors, which you call in a big word ordination, but you don't have to remember that word. And the friend of ours made the faith chest. Those are made by actually by Joyce Farrell and Ken Simmet, and they will retire from that job, so we thank them for doing that for so many years. But when our friend made the faith chest for us and gave it to us, he said, anything that is special to you, that has something to do with baptism, God, or Jesus, or is a treasure to you, please put in the box. And we thought, well, that should be easy, right? There's lots of wonderful things we can put in there. What are some of the treasures you can put in your faith chest? Great things of fun. Gold, very good. Frankincense and myrrh. What else? Your Bible you can put in there. You need to take it out sometimes to read it, though, right? Yeah, to look at the pictures at least. Yes, of course, can't just be in there. So those are great things because they bring us great joy. But then our friend said something that made me think. He said, anything that is difficult for you, where your faith helped you through, put it in the faith chest. So what are some of the difficult things in our life? That we could, yes. Flu shots, yes, you can actually put the Band-Aid that you pull off right back in there and you can say, that was a hard thing for me to do. I had to go to lots and lots of funerals. In fact, the friend who made our faith chest has died meanwhile, and I put his funeral folder, the bulletin that you receive when you go to a funeral, I put that in my faith chest. Now, why did he think that we should put the difficult things for our faith in our faith chest? Why do you think? Because we can give the difficult things to God, exactly. It is in those difficult times of our faith that we can tell God, we need you right here, right now, because you have promised us to be with us. Where did God promise us to be with us? Where did God promise us to be with us? You can remember. Your parents will remember. Should I ask them? Where did God promise to be with us? In the baptism of waters, forever and ever and ever. So if we trust that promise, he will be with us in the difficult moments and in the lighthearted moments, in the joys and in the sadness of our life. And we can give it all to God, our joys and our sad memories, because we are who? The children of God, forever and ever, now and always. That is who we are.
It's not always
and nobody can take it, no, and nobody can take it from us. And it's not always easy, but that's who we are. So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for making us your children forever and ever. Sometimes it is fun to be splashing in the waters knowing that we're your children, and sometimes we reluctantly reach into those waters to claim that we're yours. But in all circumstances, we know that you will not let us go. And for that, we are most grateful. In Christ's name, amen. Thank you, my friends. You may be seated. Oh, she decided she'll sit with different parents. That's okay. Emma does that all the time. Friends in Christ, grace and peace to you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Let me ask you a question. What makes you you? What makes you into the person that you are and that you are becoming? What is your identity marker? A lot of times it's easier for us, especially when we're parents, to point this out about our children. We know what is uniquely each and every one of them. I just had the privilege to sit with a young man, and I invited him to tell me his story. And after he was done, he said, I said, that's quite the story. And then there was this pause, and very poignantly he said, it might be, but it's the only story I know. How true. It is the only story he knows. It is your story, and this is the only story you know. You don't know any other story because that is who you are. That is who you have become. And so today it is that we celebrate what makes God's people, God's people. What makes God's people, God's people. Today we celebrate one of the two sacraments that the Lutheran Church embraces, and that is the sacrament of holy baptism. It is what we would say one of the two Lutheran identity markers. It's unshakable. It will not be taken. It is one of the markers who makes us as Lutheran Christians who we are. So what is a sacrament? Well, number one, it needs to be instituted by Jesus. And as we very well know, Holy Communion, which is the second sacrament, is instituted by Jesus. And we know from today's story that Jesus was baptized, so it is something that Jesus has instituted. That is one part of what makes a sacrament. The second part of what makes a sacrament in the Lutheran Church, is that it is a promise from God, something that God has promised, and it has a physical sign attached to it. Very simply put, in communion, the signs are what? Bread and wine. And in baptism, the physical sign is water. In communion, we have the promise of new life and forgiveness of sins. And in the baptismal waters, we become the children of God forever. Now, you have heard me say this many times. I know Pastor Dirk says about a lot of Bible verses and about a lot of holidays that they are his favorite. You don't hear me say that very often, I think, but this is actually my favorite church holiday. Not because it doesn't come with gifts and presents and all sorts of hubbub around it, but because it is the defining moment in our life as baptized Christians. It is who we are. It defines from there on everything that we become. Sadly enough, though, as I say many times, we treat baptism a lot of times like an extended warranty, something you buy just in case, right? Like you buy for your car in case it breaks down on the interstate, or your fridge in case it stops doing what it's supposed to do while you're on vacation. Baptism is not an extended warranty that we can have just in case something happens. The reality is baptism defines first and foremost who we are, and from that standpoint, everything goes from there. I asked that question yesterday, and I wasn't familiar with neither the book nor the movie, A Little Princess. Is anybody familiar with that movie? In a nutshell, it's around World War I, and it is about a father and a daughter that happened to make their life in India. And the mother has passed away, and the father, as he raises this daughter faithfully, keeps telling her, "You are a little princess." And as he gets drawn into World War I, he needs to release her into the care of a boarding school in New York. And she attends that boarding school while he is at war and makes lots of friends, and she remembers her dad telling her, "I am a little princess." Well, it happens to be that word gets to her through the headmistress that her dad has died in the war. And so as that occurs, the headmaster or headmistress takes everything from the girl, even the golden locket that holds a picture of her mom and her dad. And she banishes her with another girl up to the attic to be a servant girl for the school. She's not allowed to interact any longer with anyone in the school except for servant purposes. And as the last act is that she takes the locket, the girl is left in the attic alone with rags on her, with a little raggedy doll. And it leaks, and it's all that sad stuff that goes with the sad movie. But she finds this piece of chalk, and she draws this circle around herself on the floor. She lays down and tries to sleep. And she says, "This is the circle of protection, and I am a little princess." And that circle and that statement become for her the strength of which she operates. So as the headmistress or the headmaster gets after her and tries to make her life very difficult, she one time stands up and puts her hands on her side and says, "But I am a little princess." And she operates out of this realm, not out of arrogance, but out of the standpoint that no matter what anybody says or claims or does to her, she is acclaimed princess. Well, it comes at the end of the story that she's accused of stealing money or whatever, and so the police is going to carry her out, and wouldn't you know, it's a real Hollywood movie. It's an old one, though. Her dad does come back as she clung to this promise. What is the vital part that I like us to remember as we journey through the story of baptism is the circle out of which she operates. I am a princess, and nobody can take it from me. See, our culture does the opposite, right? Our culture says you can only be a princess if you first met your prince, number two, achieved the status of a princess, number three, looked like a princess, number four, and five, and six, and seven, right? We need to work for that status of who we become. It's not given to us. It's not handed to us. We need to achieve everything who we become. Now, the waters of baptism frees us from all of those demands, from all of those pressures, from everything that society places on us and says, no, first and foremost, before you do anything. That's why we do infant baptism. You are a child of God, and from that you can operate. You can't tag it on. Baptism is not a tag on. Baptism becomes the center of who we are and how we operate into everything that we do. And so it is that baptism frees us from certain things. And there's exactly four that Martin Luther mentions in his small catechism. Martin Luther writes that baptismal freedom comes to us in the ordinary things. And why that is a freedom, I'll explain to you in just a moment. It frees us also from the chains of sin, death, and the devil. It frees us to serve our neighbor, and it gives us the freedom to start over daily. So why is it a freedom that God can be found in ordinary things? Well, I don't know about your life, but my life so far consists day after day out of laundry piles, meals to cook, a job to attend to. I don't know what else is in there. Oh, schedules to keep, people to make happy or not happy. It's pretty mundane, pretty ordinary. There's nothing much flashy about my life. Now, yours might be different, but mine isn't very flashy. Mine is rather ordinary. And when I'm done with one meal, guess what? What are we going to eat tomorrow? Well, I don't know. Go and ask the neighbors, maybe. I'm out of shorts. Well, then maybe it's time you load the washer. You see, I encounter multiple times in my day people who tell me what an emotional high it was when they went to worship somewhere else. Good for them. I'm glad. I hope you can live on that emotional high for the rest of your life, because for me, there are emotional highs in my Christian faith. They would be my confirmation, probably, hopefully. They would be my ordination. They would be the baptism of my children, my children's confirmation, my parents' anniversary, my own wedding. Those are all very spiritual, emotional highs where I feel so close to God that I am almost inseparate. Like, what was that? Lena and, what's his name? Ole. Ole and Lena, remember from last week? They were sitting so that the light couldn't even get through, and Pastor Dirk liked it. I have moments like that with God. But for the most part of my life, I feel like we're separated. Because it's pretty darn ordinary. We're going from one place, from one laundry pile to the next. There isn't much in between. And why is that freedom? Because God is in those ordinary things with us daily. Don't you think Mary had laundry to do for Jesus? That wasn't a magical rope. That was Joseph, remember? Don't you think that Jesus learned to be a carpenter? That's pretty ordinary stuff. He probably hit his thumb too once in a while. God is in the ordinary, with Mary and Martha as they cook a meal, as they grieve the loss of their brother. He's with Moses as he struggles to accept his call, with the Israelites as they scream in the desert that they feel alone and separated. God is in the ordinary things. For me, that's freedom. I don't need to deliver for you an emotional high. It frees me up to be the preacher that God called me to be. It also gives me freedom from sin, death, and the devil. Paul writes in Titus 3, and Luther quotes him in the Small Catechism, "He saved us in virtue of his own mercy by the washing of regeneration and renewal in the Holy Spirit, which he poured out upon us richly through Jesus Christ our Savior, so that we might be justified by his grace and become heirs and hope of eternal life. It doesn't say justified by your works. It says justified by his grace. So as we look at our baptism and how we treat it and how we become the children of God, Jesus didn't die so that we can have a ritual that we can fulfill or another milestone that we can add. He died so that we can have a relationship with our living God. See, while the world might scream at me, you are all the mistakes accumulated that you made. You are your old habits that you will never be able to break. You are your past. You are defined by all your shortcomings. And trust me, the devil reminds me of that very frequently. I can go to the baptismal font and can say, I'm not my mistakes. I'm not my old habits. I'm not my past. I don't care what you say, because I know that I'm beautiful and I'm a reflection of God. I'm forgiven, I'm loved, and I'm free. Now, I don't know what that makes you, but it gives me great freedom to know that sin, death, and the devil have no power over me. In Romans 6, we hear, we were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might walk in newness of life. The question becomes, do we want to walk in newness of life? What do I mean by that? Well, those baptismal waters free us from sin, death, and the devil. They make us and call us to lay down everything that we hold on to that keeps us in fear and keeps us little. Have you ever thought that we really actually like holding on to our little fears? Trust me, I like to hold on to my grudges. I like to warm things up when I'm mad. Just ask my husband. I have a memory like an elephant. It doesn't need to have happened yesterday. I can bring it up from 30 years ago. We like to hold on to our grudges. We like to hold on to our old life. It might be freeing to know that we don't need to live with our mistakes. But when it comes to other people's mistakes, we like to hold on to them. Why? Because once we need to let go, once we need to let go of all the stuff we hold on to, what happens? We're freed, and things can be filling our life. And sometimes change is scary. Because once you let go of the stuff that you have a hard time letting go of, you have no control anymore. And change happens. And that's scary at times. Very scary. We're like Peter when we say, oh no, Jesus, you can't wash my feet. I need to wash your feet. See, we are much easier people that like to be in control. At least I am. Maybe you aren't. But what happens when we accept this freedom and this gift that God gives us in baptism? We are free to serve our neighbor. Because we become grateful people. And gratitude does change everything. Gratitude changes everything. Why is that so important that we serve our neighbor in the waters of baptism, we receive that call? Because as we become the servant people that God calls us to be, and I say that over and over, and I will say it until the day I die, I'm sure, is if we don't serve, people won't see Jesus. It is our call as the people of God to serve, because that is, for a lot of people in this world, the only Jesus they will ever meet is you. That's a high calling. Not just for pastors, but for all people, the priesthood of all believers. You, through the waters of baptism, remember that's the circle out of operation. You become the Jesus that people will see. I read a quote as I prepared for this sermon that really stuck with me. And it goes like this. Our life as a Christian should make non-believers question their disbelief in God. Our life as a Christian should make non-believers question their disbelief in God. You see, Jesus didn't just change the world through words. He changed the world through his actions. He acted upon the words that he preached. And so if we want for baptism to make a difference in people, they need to hear more than our words. They need to feel our actions and our attitudes in the joys and the highs of our faith and in the lows of our faith and in the ordinary times. In the in-betweens, when we think really there is not much going on. And because that is such a high calling, the fourth and most important, I don't know if it's most important, but one of the four legs of baptism is that we get a daily fresh start, because we will fail. We will come short. I'm sure of that. And there's the ordinary things that remind me. What happens after you are done with 1 week of laundry? You have another week of laundry. What happens after you're done with one set of meals? You have another set of meals. And that's how it is every day. Just like we have our chores every day, we also have the opportunity to rise anew every day with God. We're not defined by our mistakes, not defined by our past, but given a fresh start each and every day in the waters of baptism. It's like the daily shower, that we need to be reminded that we are forgiven forgivers. I might not be able to forgive my neighbor today, but God says, just try again. It's like little children starting to learn to walk. They try again and again and again, sometimes more successful than others. But that's how it is as the people of God. We get to try again and again and again and again. Sometimes we're on mountaintops with God, and sometimes it's just going to be an ordinary day. So as you play with water this next week, this coming week, just pay a little attention to how often you actually use water. So you make your morning coffee, boil the potatoes for supper, do the laundry, rinse the dishes. Be reminded that God is in all and each of those moments, and that they call us to act upon that grace and to be witnesses that we are the children of God and no one can take it from us. Thanks be to God. Amen. I invite you to stand as we sing the hymn of the day, Christ, When For Us You Were Baptized, 304.
to ask Sandy to come forward. We are going to celebrate the baptismal milestone. I think the names of the children who were baptized are all printed in the bulletin.
Good morning. As he said, the Milestone Ministry provides an opportunity for a partnership between the home and the congregation in nurturing and passing on faith throughout our entire family life from birth to death. So now we are honoring the 2015 baptisms. As I call your children's name, we would love you to come forward. Macy Lynn Wiedenbach, Brinley Marie Olson, Hannah Marie Bomberger, Drew Imani Moore, Greenlee Madeline Moore, Bodie Harper Moore, Adelaide Michaela Winters, Liam Marcus Murtha, David James Sweer, Emma Grace Hagmeyer, Jackson James Entrigger, Evan Michael Williams, Leighton Matthew Gust, Lennox May Jerkowski, Dalen Leroy Grayson, Cash Douglas Julian Hansen, Elia Marie Christensen, and Hudson Harold Podraski.
There they come. Look how they have changed. It's all that good baptismal water that makes you grow. Do you want to pick out a color? There we go. And don't know that you're Cash and not Chase. There we go. You're welcome. Well, I like you to gather up here in front, and then as you leave, you are also invited to choose a faith chest. As I said, we thank Joyce Farrell and Ken Simmet for making those faith chests, and you have a washcloth and the rubber ducky. We'll talk about that at our little educational moment. All the faith chests are really the same. There's a little plaque in there to remind them, and I like us to pray together. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the gift of water that reminds us that we're yours and that we can operate out of that assurance that there's neither death nor life, nor things present nor things to come that will ever be able to separate us from your love. In Christ's name, we thank you for this precious gift. Amen.
Amen.
Please choose a faith chest that goes home with you, and I will see you up in the fireside room after service.
Always a difficult choice, right?
You think they are all the same, but they're really not.
Yeah, they are all unique. Did you choose one, Lorenzo? Next time, right? The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
You may share God's peace with one another. This time we are going to receive an offering.
You may be seated. Thank you.
please rise to the auditorium.
Thanks for the gift of baptism and the gifts of grace in the world. We pray for the church, the world, and all those in need.
For your church on earth, that your Spirit guides your children. Unite us in our common call to live out your justice and stand with our siblings of every faith community. Lord, in your mercy.
Give your people of every land the tools and strength to care for one another and for our environment. Give passion to strive for justice to your people. Bless all countries with the courage to follow what is wise and good. Lord, in your mercy.
Lift up the poor and oppressed, ease the troubled minds and hearts of those in turmoil, and surround those who are ill with the comforts of good medicine and good friends, signs of your healing. We pray especially for all those we quietly name in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy.
Guide those preparing for baptism, their sponsors, and this assembly, so that we will live into the promises made in baptism. Lead us all to Scripture, to Holy Supper, and toward justice and peace. Lord, in your mercy.
Into your hands, gracious God, we command all of your beloved for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Christ our Lord.
Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look up on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. You may be seated. We have a few announcements.
Yep, and one temple talk. But to the announcements, your annual reports are out and they are complete at this time. There are annual reports laying on the back of the church, and on top lays the financial statement that was still missing out of the printed version. Please mark your calendars. Next week, after the 12 o'clock service, is our annual meeting. Please join us for that time together. There's also the annual bingo bash that is going to happen on the 31st. We could use a few things for the bingo bash, such as soup. I think I see a sign up downstairs. So please stop in the narthex. It's a fun time that we all get together doing not much than having fun, and we'll be hearing about that in just a little bit. The quilters are grateful for your support, but they will no longer need blankets that go in the middle. Betty said, we're stepping it up a notch. Now for Betty to say that, that will be surprised what we'll find. And then the Altar Guild, though, and is in need of your help to set up communion for both services 8:45 and 11. If you're interested, please come see me or talk to Lana. Would you quick wave, Lana? There she is. Talk to her. It's really no magic. It's just one of those ordinary things. At this time, I think Lori is going to have a temple talk.
Lori, you can take her with.
Good morning. I would like to invite each and every one of you to the pre-Super Bowl Bingo Bash that will be on January 31st downstairs at noon. This is a free event, and we'll have lots of hot, warm soup and cookies and crackers and bread and butter and tables full of desserts that each time you win a bingo, you get to pick a whole dessert to bring back to your table to share or not. That's up to you. Okay. If you'd like to help out, like Pastor Constanza said, there are sign-ups down in the narthex for you to write down if you'd like to bring something. But if not, most importantly, we would just like you to put the date on your calendar so that you can be here. It is the week before the Super Bowl, okay, the 31st, which is the Pro Bowl day. So please come at noon and enjoy a great time of fun and fellowship. If your team's still in it to win the big game, we hope they do. If you're a Bengals fan, sorry. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much. Please rise for the sending hymn, Remember and Rejoice, number 454. And I'd like to thank Donna again. Thank you so much.
Serves the Lord.